This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. Today on Dreamland, we've got two great guests. A lot of you know them, Trish and Rob Magregor. They, of course, are podcasters on unknowncountry.com. They have been with us for years, and their podcast goes back even farther than that, the Mystical Underground. It's always fun. Trish is one of the best astrologers I've ever known. Rob is just a great guy. He does things too. Anyway, we're going to get into this. They work together. Among their books are Phenomena, Harnessing Your Psychic Abilities, The Secrets of Spirit Communication, Sensing the Future, and Aliens in the Backyard. I think we've talked about probably all of these books on the show. They're always loads of fun. And today, man, God, we got something special for you. This is called Mind-Blowing Synchronicities. And my mind is blowing, I'll tell you right now. This is going to be a wonderful, fun show. We're going to have a great time because let me tell you something about the world we live in. We don't know where the hell we are. I need you, Trish and Rob. But they can tell us a lot of things about what it's like to not know where we are. Guys, welcome to Dreamland. Hello.
Fighting us.
Okay.
There you are.
All right. Mind-blowing synchronicities. When I picked that up, that book up, I thought, no, I refuse, absolutely refuse. I'm not going to have my mind blown by any of these synchronicities. Well, there's lots of them in here, and they're all mind-blowing.
That's because your life is mind-blowing, Whitley.
Mind-blown. Of course, everybody does. Or if you don't, if you don't like to have your mind blown, it's time to turn off the radio or the TV or YouTube or whatever, because this is what we do here. All right. Let me ask you, let me start with this. It's a simple question. What inspired you to write about synchronicity? When did you become involved with the phenomenon?
Well, for me, it started in college when somebody gave me a copy of the I Ching, and Carl Jung had written the introduction, and the whole thing was about synchronicity. It was the Wilhelm edition.
And for me, when I met Trish, I was working as a newspaper reporter. And I was interviewing her for an article. She was teaching English as a second language to Cuban refugees. And after our conversation, she says to me, you know what synchronicity is? And I said, yeah, I've heard about it. And so we ended up getting together, seeing each other more, and we both had something in common. We wanted to get out of our jobs to a freelance writing. I was already working as a freelancer on the side, writing magazine articles, and we ended up quitting our jobs. And the first book we tried to write was a synchronicity book, but we didn't have the abilities then, the knowledge, and we put it off. And years later, Seven Secrets of Synchronicity came along, my first one.
Well, you know, it's a fascinating book, The Seven Secrets. I don't believe we interviewed about that, did we? That's a long time ago. Or did we?
That's 10 years ago.
I mean, it's called The Seven Secrets of Synchronicity. So I hope one of you at least remembers some of those secrets, because we need to talk about them, obviously. Give me some idea of what they are.
Well, Rob, let's see, Seven Secrets.
I happen to have the book.
Good. You don't need to hold it up.
Okay. It doesn't seem to get in focus. Seven Secrets of Synchronicity. Or secret one is called the knowing. And then the heart, the theory, the creative, the clusters, the trickster, and the global. Those are the seven secrets as the label.
Okay, well, one that is after my own heart, since I live with a bunch of invisible tricksters. Let's talk about the trickster for a minute.
Okay, the trickster. The problem with the trickster is that I think there are two facets to the trickster. There's the trickster who kind of does stuff that makes you laugh at yourself, just kind of pokes fun at you. And mm-hmm. then there's the dark trickster, which seems to be more prevalent these days. And the dark trickster, I think, is the one that's kind of, I don't know, I don't like the dark trickster. It's not very nice.
No, I wouldn't think so. Well, I did have experience with the trickster in my life. I've had many experiences with the trickster, but this one stands out as being particularly disappointing. When I was in college, I was a bad boy in terms of going steady with more than one girl.
Oh, that is trickster stuff.
Yeah, and my friends all said, listen, you can't do it. It doesn't work. They will end up together. They will end up in the same room together with you. And I've said, it's impossible. One of them is a sorority girl. The other is an independent. One of them is a tri-delt and, you know, pretty conservative. The other's a hippie. They're not going to be in the same world. They're not even in the same world. One of them blows grass all the time. One of them wouldn't get near even liquor. So, you know, and they're both beautiful and both fun in different ways. And I'm having a great time. So I walk into a restaurant. Just a few days later, and there they are sitting at the table together having dinner. And I didn't even know they knew each other. And then and they both looked up at me so delighted to see their boyfriend. And that fire just burned, let me put it that way.
Really, that's so bad.
I would say that's the trickster at work.
Yeah, that is the trickster.
Yeah.
We had an interesting trickster synchronicity when I appeared on the show UFO Hunters a number of years ago, and Trish and I went out to Andros Island for the show to be interviewed there. And it was related to a book called Beyond the Bermuda Triangle that I co-wrote with Bruce Gernon. And what happened is that the UFO Hunters, Bill Burns was kind of the leader of that group of three. Wanted to interview. One of the things they wanted to do is to get into the secret Navy base out there called OTEC, where there's related to UFOs under underwater vessel unknown vessels, and talk to the captain. What was his title? Trish, I can't remember the. The one who is in charge of the base.
Under the base.
Honcho.
Yeah, and the head honcho. And not only did the producers kept calling, and not only did they not reject him, but they never responded. So Bill Burns says, let's just walk up there and see if we can get inside and ask for a tour, and maybe we can meet the captain. And so we drove up and stopped about 100 yards away, and the camera guy got out and got ready, the sound guy, and we were going to start heading up to the gate when suddenly these two cop cars appeared, and they blocked the gate. They didn't just face the gate. They faced each other, their noses, like facing each other, blocking the gate. And then this black helicopter lifted up from behind the gate and came over us hovering, and Bill looks at us and said, you know, I don't think they're interested in having us go any further. So that seemed to be the end of it until 5 months later. We were in Sarasota, Florida. We were helping our daughter Megan move into her college dorm room, and Trish and I decided to go downtown and get a bite to eat for dinner. And came upon this restaurant with an outdoor setting, and they had a live band. It was really crowded, though, and there was only one table, a high top, left that had two seats open. There were two people on the other side. We sat down and asked them if it was okay to join them. They said, fine. And when there was a break in the music, we started talking to them. And it turns out the guy we're talking to was the head of
Autumn. He was the commander.
The what?
He was the commander.
The commander of the base. At the time, we were there. And so I'm telling him, about this story about you being on UFO hunters, and that we had tried to see him, and I wanted to explore the whole story. Well, the music started, and it was difficult to talk. And then he wrote down on a little scrap of paper his email address, and he said, "I want to talk to you." Then when there was a break in the music, he said, "Why don't we go over to another bar where it's quieter?" And for some reason, Trish and I said we were tired and we're going to go back. And I never found that email again. I never found it. And so that's a trickster synchronicity, because there we were with the commander of the police and had the chance to talk to him. And he, you know, when I first mentioned UFOs, he looks at his girlfriend and says, "I need another drink."
You know, that's spectacular. It really is spectacular. And, you know, pre-Dreamlanders, those of you who listen to the ads, we're going to surprise you with some new ads one of these days, but probably this isn't the day. Anyway, we'll be right back.
And by the way, go to unknowncountry.com and get on the newsletter. It's easy to do. It's completely free. It comes out every Friday like clockwork, and you'll enjoy it. And it keeps you up to date with all the stuff going on around here, what the next Dreamland's going to be, what the next subscriber events are going to be, who's going to be in the subscriber video chat. Because, you know, as subscribers, you get a lot of chances to chat personally with these guests. It happens all the time on UC. So go to UC and get started. Unknowncountry.com. I am working on the first book to go into any reliable and accurate detail about the visitors' bodies, what they are like, how they function, and also how they relate to us, how their perceptual system works in comparison to ours, and what the disconnect is, because there's a major disconnect here. If there wasn't a disconnect, disclosure would have happened 50 years ago. There's a disconnect. The book is about fixing that disconnect. It'll be out as soon as I get it finished, before Christmas, I'm sure. If you've got any questions about the show, questions about anything, my weird life or your weird life, anything like that, DM me the questions. I'm here. I'm not far away, and so I will respond.
You know, folks, Unknown Country is not just a place to stay to avoid paying a subscription fee. It is a place that has a very warm, rich community of experiencers and people who are interested in this experience. It is not full of trolls, and there's no politics on the site, or very little. So it's a place where you can go if you're a spiritual explorer or interested in the UFO question, and have a lot of fun with people who are on your wavelength. And I think it's a lot of them are very wonderful, extraordinary people. So go to unknowncountry.com, sign up, and join the fun. That's the only thing I can say, join the fun. All right, now let's get back to the wild and crazy life of the McGregors. And, you know, you have to wonder, going back to when you guys came into the world, was there anything unusual about that? I don't think so. I mean, there wasn't, in my case, you know, I just had a very hard babyhood because I was allergic to mother's milk, of all things.
God.
Yeah, and that's why my siblings used to say he is an alien. And then they would try to convince me that my parents found me in a field.
That's not nice.
Okay. Let's talk about the, yeah, I'm looking at this list of questions here, and my listeners know I write an enormous number of questions and shock my guests by knowing their books. I actually read the books. Let's get back into mind-blowing synchronicities. I mean, I've already heard a really mind-blower just now. But let's talk about the one that starts the book out, which is the Hurricane Andrew one, your novel, Storm Surge. Trish, I think this is your baby.
Yeah, right, it is. Okay. On August 14th, 1992, I mailed my novel, Storm Surge, off to my editor at Hyperion. That same day, a wave moved off the coast of Africa, and 2 days later, it became a hurricane, Hurricane Andrew. And it turned out to be one of the most powerful on record, with winds that at some point were in excess of 200 miles an hour. On August 24th, it slammed into Homestead, Florida as a Cat 5 and devastated it. Okay, in Storm Surge, the hurricane was also a Cat 5 with an A name, Alfonso. The real storm and the fictive storm both had tightly impacted eyes. I think they were 10 miles across, and both hit relatively small areas in South Florida. The similarities and the timing completely freaked me out, though, that I'd mailed the book to my editor on the same day that Andrew, its wave, had moved off of Africa. And I think that's when I really realized that through creativity, we can sometimes tune into the future. So I promised myself I wouldn't ever again write any novel that was about a hurricane, but of course I did. And eventually there was a book called Category 5 that came out a month before Hurricane Katrina. That's a whole other story.
Well, you know, this is certainly not the only book that has done that. Of course, right. The famous one is Wreck of the Titan, mm-hmm. published in 1898, which is about the sinking. Is it? There's no way, other way to put it. It's about the sinking of the Titanic.
Right.
The problem is the sinking of the Titanic took place in 1912, 14 years later. And I think Dean Koontz has got a book that has one of those highly predictive things in it too. It's interesting that, you know, writers get an awful lot of trouble, and that must be a rather shocking experience for you.
Well, you know, in Stephen King's book On the Craft, he has a great description about how when he's writing, the rest of the world goes away. And I think it's at that point that you're outside of time and you can see all of time. It's, you know, in some way, yeah. You can sense it.
That's, what is that going on in your deal, guys? You're always beeping.
That's my computer. I don't know how to turn that sound off.
Okay. Well, all right. Let's keep.
Whitley, would you like to hear another one related to creativity?
Yeah, that's what we're here for. So, yeah, as long as it's not a beep.
So like in 1970 or 72, Arthur Koestler, who wrote a book on synchronicity, wrote an article in the Sunday Times of London and just asking the public for striking coincidences. And boy, did he come up with a good one that was sent to him by a man named Nigel Parker, who talked about one of his relatives named Richard Parker, who had died on, had been eaten in cannibalism on a raft after the ship had sunk. And he was a 16-year-old cabin boy. And four of the people got away on this raft, and they caught a turtle and they ate the turtle. And then they were, went on and on days. And so they decided the only way they're going to survive is three of them are going to survive, and they were going to eat the fourth person. So they drew straws or something that where they picked they picked Richard anyhow, the young guy, because he had been drinking water and he was delirious. I don't think they picked straws. That was in the related story. So that's what happened. He was eaten, and then they were rescued, the three of them, by a ship called the Montezuma, Montezuma, Mexico King, was a cannibal, actually. So that was the synchronicity there. But the real creative synchronicity was 50 years earlier. Edgar Allan Poe wrote a novel called The Narrative of Arthur Gordon, Arthur Gordon Pym, 1838. And it was about included in the novel was a shipwreck where there were four survivors. One of them was a cabin boy named Richard Parker, the very same name. And in the story, they pick straws or something like that, and he gets the short one, and they eat him. So that is such a synchronicity, having the same name 50 years before. And he's also a cabin boy, a teenage cabin boy. I think his age was like 1 or 2 years different, but wow, that's a mind-blowing one to me.
Well, yeah, I should say so. Let me get me back in the picture here. Frantically pushing buttons.
Don DeLillo's book in 1985, he wrote it called White Noise. In a world premiere, a movie was made of it at the 79th Venice International Film Festival in 2022. It was then released in selected cinemas in November of that year and became a streaming Netflix thing in December. Okay, here's the weird thing. White Noise is about a train derailment in Ohio, and the train derailment actually happened in Ohio. In the book, it was in a fictional town of Blacksmith, Ohio. Now, the movie was filmed almost entirely in Ohio. In the film, a tanker truck loaded with toxic flammable material crashes into a passing train. And because of the truck driver's drunk driving, the train derails in the countryside, the tanker is crushed and releases a viscous substance. So a fireball erupts. The rest of the film deals with the aftermath of the crash in both large and small personal ways. Okay, the real event involved in the train derailment happened February 3rd, 2023 in East Palestine, Ohio, a town near the Pennsylvania border. A Norfolk Southern train with 20 cars containing hazardous materials derailed, caught fire, and created a horrendous cloud of toxic material. In real life, the derailed and burned cars contained dangerous chemicals that could basically kill people. anyway, I mean, that the parallels there are just mind-blowing.
Yeah.
A book written in 1985.
So, you know, and it happens. And it definitely happens. Now, it's just the question of what does happen. Now, one of the other things that happens is precognition. And you start the book out with precognition. And I've always been fascinated by precognition. I knew, in fact, I still know a wonderful woman, Elizabeth. She's a friend of Jeff Kripal's, and she wrote a book called Struck by Lightning. And what happened to her then was, after she came back, she had a near-death experience. And after she came back, she had changed. And now she had precogs of especially plane crashes. And they were really scary and dangerous, terrible things that were happening. And it really, she had to struggle with, what are precogs?
Well, I mean, if you look at Minority Report, the movie with Tom Cruise, in the movie, there were three precogs who could sense the future, who were connected. They floated in a pool and were connected, I believe, to each other and to the control room. And they could foresee events that were about to happen. But the real precognition is the same way. Precognition is sensing the future, basically. Whereas telepathy is mind-to-mind communication, clairvoyance and remote viewing are seeing things at a difference. At a distance. What's interesting is that Daryl Byrne of Cornell conducted a series of experiments with Cornell students. And this was interesting. 9 experiments that involved 1,000 students who viewed erotic photos, and they found statistically significant results confirming that many people can glimpse the future. In one experiment, he provided students with a computer monitor and it showed a pair of curtains side by side. and participants were instructed to choose the curtain that hid an erotic picture. Across 200 sessions, the participants correctly identified the future position of the erotic picture 53.1% of the time, well beyond chance. So I love that. I love that experiment.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
You know, it shows that feelings have a role in perception as well.
Yeah. I didn't hear that.
It shows that one's feelings, the emotions, have a role in precognition. Where most these laboratory experiments, the accuracy starts to go down because people get bored and they're not really into it. Where if you're looking for an erotic photo, it's another matter.
You're
a college student. The combination is precognitive.
Well, I was trying to remember the Dean Kuntz book, and I got it here. There's a book he wrote called Eyes of Darkness that has an incredible precog in it. Mm-hmm. There's a biological weapon called Wuhan 400, see where I'm going, developed in a lab near the city of Wuhan in China. Mm-hmm. And it's eerily similar, of course, to COVID. And now we're on the fence as to whether or not that COVID was a laboratory experiment gone wild or exactly what it was. And it does happen. It definitely does happen. And of course, my book, The Key, is full of precognitive stuff. So. Let's move on, though. You know what we need to do? We can't move on yet, we Dreamlanders, because we gotta move you to do something. What, I'm not sure, but you'll find out. We'll be right back.
Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. Who are they? Why are they here? What do they want with us? Why is it all so secret? All of these questions are explored in my new book, Them, in an entirely new way. What do Close Encounter reports tell us about what the visitors want with us? What is the military's experience? And can our memories be trusted? Can anything be trusted? Them answers all of these questions in a totally new way. It's available in hardcover, softcover, as a Kindle, and as an audiobook, read by me. Get Them today, and you can get it from the unknowncountry.com store, signed by me.
Okay. We're back. We referred briefly to feelings a few moments ago. Mm-hmm. And now there are, you talked in the book in the about planetary empaths. Can you tell us a little bit about what they are, planetary empaths, and how they relate to natural disasters, and give us some examples of a few, if you could.
We kind of stumbled across this. Some people, when we first started our blog, I think in 2009 or 2010, there were some people who seemed to be picking up on events, global events, like destructive events, not just hurricanes, but explosions and bombings and that kind of thing. And it seems that they were picking up, the way they picked up these events was through physical symptoms, like the migraines, ringing ears, fever, heart palpitations, dizziness, nausea, insomnia. Some people fled from the ears, and a sense of real malaise and dread. And so we started putting things together and realized, you know, like some people, they couldn't specify a place, but they could pretty much specify an event. Like if, like there was one woman who had a terrible fever for no apparent cause and a terrible headache, and it turned out what she was picking up on was a volcanic eruption somewhere. But for the most part, these impacts couldn't specify where what the event was or where it was going to happen, but the symptoms were so strong that they knew something was coming.
Okay, I don't know if you guys can hear that sound.
Yeah.
Yeah. Uh-oh.
It's very strange.
Sounds like running water.
Okay, it's coming from your end, Rob.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Now it's gone.
That's gone, yeah.
Okay. All right. Now, so, you know, in a sense, Elizabeth Krohn, the author of Struck by Lightning, is a planetary impact to this day. And there is something about a violent experience like that seems to retune a person. And I wonder why we are not all like that. Why don't we all have precogs? And if you guys, I mean, you've obviously had some spectacular ones. You described with that base commander was extraordinary. Let's move on to major political events, because you touch on that in the book, and the way synchronicities seem to line up in the face of these events. And can you speak to that from the text, if you will?
Yeah, I mean, well, these days, it's like political events are like mass events. Everyone either reads about it or hears about it. And I think one of the most striking happened on January 15th, 2009. That was the same day that George Bush gave his final speech to the country. And it was when United Flight 1545 took off from LaGuardia and collided with a flock of geese and the engine failed. And the captain, Kelsey Burnett Sullenberg, on the Sully, was instructed to land at Teterboro Airport, but he knew the plane couldn't reach it. So he announced to the 150 passengers that they were going to land on the Hudson. I can't imagine what people in the plane felt at that moment. Okay, 90 seconds later, Sully glides the Airbus 320 over the George Washington Bridge and lands on the Hudson River. All 155 people on board survive. The first rescue boat to reach the scene was named after Thomas Jefferson, ranked as one of the best presidents and author of the Declaration of Independence. Now, what are the odds of that? You know, with these types of synchronicities, the odds are usually huge.
There's another good one that relates to politics of Obamacare. So in May of 2008, there's a contentious debate going on between the Democrats and Republicans on Obamacare, and Ted Kennedy at the time had been diagnosed with GBM, glioblastoma, which is a malignant brain tumor. And he was having, missing a lot of Congress, but because of his care, he was undergoing. But he kept coming back, and his big thing was the healthcare bill. He just pushed it and pushed it, During the last year of his life, he died in 2009, and Obamacare was passed in 2010. So then we skip ahead to 2017, and now there's the debate to repeal Obamacare. And John McCain was diagnosed with the same thing that Kennedy had, GBM, and underwent surgery. So the repeal was delayed until he returned. And when he returned, he did the unthinkable. He voted against the repeal, and Obamacare remained. And so it's interesting that the two characters both were dying of the same thing, were involved in the healthcare bill, Obamacare. And, you know, they both played a major role in it.
Yeah, at the time this was going on, and when McCain was diagnosed, the Republicans were trying to repeal Obamacare by scaling back Medicaid and doing away with the mandate. And they wanted to ram the bill through with very little time for anyone to read it. And, you know, McCain just comes in and votes to repeal what they're trying to do. So to me, this could also be a trickster synchronicity. You know, they were geared up for passing this thing, getting rid of Obamacare, and McCain became the trickster. And maybe the reason he voted against it was because he realized that the cost involved, which at the time was $60,000 to $70,000 for his care, would require, you know, would kill most people. Most people wouldn't be able to do it.
Right. I'm not going to get into politics, but I certainly am glad that that worked out the way it did for my own sake and the sake of everyone I know. Now let's move on. There's a wonderful chapter called Weird Travel from Here to There. I love that chapter. I love the whole book. It's the kind of book where you think, oh, what am I going to do this evening? It doesn't involve staring at the TV. And you see that on your table and you pick it up, and it really sings. It's fun. And it gets you thinking. It really does get you thinking. And let's talk about travel synchronicities, because that's a really interesting subject in my mind. I don't know which of you would like to start, but let's get into that.
Well, I think one of the reasons travel synchronicities happen is because you're out of your regular routine, you know, and you're kind of open to, okay, you're on the road. Let's see what's going to happen to us today. And when Rob and I think it was 1987, we had taken a trip to Venezuela. It was my first trip back since my family had left. And we were in the Mercosur airport. And there were all these young guards with machine guns, and because at the time the Colombian Venezuelan drug trade was really active. And so they were all, we'd go through this line and this guard says, open your bag, you have to see what's inside. So the guy in front of us, who was dressed in a suit, looked like a regular business guy, had just a briefcase with him. So he put it down on the whatever it was, the counter, and he opens it up. And inside he has one thing. It was a book I wrote, is Alison Drake, and it was called Fevered. Well, it's not like I could even say, hey, dude, that's my book, you know, because I had no proof that I was Alison Drake. What's interesting is the title really described what that place felt like then, with all these young guards around with their guns. And
Trish is kind of missing one point too. This man was very strange. I mean, he was very tall, first of all. He's wearing a three-piece suit. He was traveling just with this briefcase, because we had all of our luggage there, because the way the situation was, you had to have all your luggage with you. And that's all he had. And it's just Trish's book. And he went ahead and we never saw him. He walked into the plane. We never saw him again. It was like a Man in Black experience to me.
Yeah, I should say so. Okay, so
story, Rob.
What's that?
Tell your Zen story.
Oh yeah, yeah. This is another travel experience. I had traveling in South America, and I met a young woman. This is before I knew Trish, and we had communicated, and she said she was going to be in Miami, and so we got together, and when she came to Miami, she came with a guy who was at the time was her boyfriend, I guess, and he was like a spiritual guy who had a little like New Age church in Negril, Jamaica, and they'd come from Jamaica, and so they stayed for 2-3 days, and then I took them to the airport. I was en route to the airport, and we got into this very heavy spiritual discussion, and there was just this emotional element involved, this a very intense feeling that in that car among us, and it was very positive, but the man was a little strange, I should say. And so as we're talking, a car passes by, and he points to the license plate. Look, it says that license plate, Zen 665. And then he says, wouldn't it be interesting if we saw Zen 666? Not 2 minutes later, a car passes us by with that very license plate, Zen 666. How did that? Was just one of the most incredible synchronicities I've ever experienced. And I, again, 2-3 years later, I saw that car again, Zen 666. So it's a crazy one, but you know, it can't be explained. You know, it's just so unlikely.
We're going to take a brief break again, and we'll be right back.
Introduction to the 2022 edition, An Awakening World. Since Communion was published in October of 1987, there has been a significant advance in how we understand the presence that most people think of as aliens. In recent years, this advance has accelerated steadily. We are right at the edge of official admission that somebody is here, and along with it, acceptance of this as a fact. But who? Or should that be what? When Communion was written, somebody claiming alien contact was publicly called a liar or pitied or being mentally disturbed. I experienced these reactions. Only, more or less in secret and to my great surprise, something else happened. As soon as the book was published, there was an explosion of interest. Derided and suppressed though it was, contact between human beings and the entities I had begun to call the visitors was not only happening, it was proving to be more widespread than anybody realized. And yet, due to social engineering of some kind, possibly originating with government agencies that had realized what was going on and also understood that they were powerless to stop it, the entire culture, from science and the academy to the man on the street, was being led to believe that it was all lies and craziness. Well, it's not all lies and craziness. And the way to find out more, and if you'd like to listen, go to audible.com and sign up and get a copy of Communion read by me.
We're talking to Trish and Rob Magregor. Their new book, Mind-Blowing Synchronicities, and true to their word, it is indeed full of mind-blowing synchronicities. I personally am having a lot of fun with this, and I hope you guys out there are too. Sometimes we go on a lighter journey on Dreamland. Other times we're very serious, but this is sort of in both directions, because it's a reminder that the world doesn't work quite the way it seems to work. Anne always used to say, synchronicities mean you're on your soul's plan. And I would say to her, what do you mean by that? She would say, Whitley, you'll find out. She said, not in this life. And I said, oh, okay. And so I wait to find out. But I think that what she was saying was that it's something related to what she said right after she passed on, when she was still in close contact with me. She said, Whitley, this is all a game. It's a game. And that gets me to the issue of synchronicities and your personal life. And there's a wonderful chapter called Crisis, and how you can, synchronicities can help you get through your personal crises. And this end involves your sister, Mary.
Yeah, that was, her death was a real shock. First of all, I'm the older sister. She's younger. And she was the healthiest person I knew, you know, somebody who went to Spanga every day. And I mean, you know, she was just a health freak. And so the eve of my birthday in 2023, I get a call from my brother-in-law, and he says, Trish, Mary's, or it was in the afternoon, he says, Mary's in the hospital. They don't know what's wrong with her. And, you know, she's got, he gave me the statistics about her blood pressure and everything. So I thought, well, that's weird. I mean, she just wasn't somebody who would go to the hospital, you know, unless she was really feeling awful. Well, then that evening, actually half an hour before my birthday started, he called and he said she died. I mean, the shock was so profound for me. And so we got in the car the next day, 2 days later, and drove up to Marietta, Georgia, where they lived. And Megan eventually flew in to join us. So 2 days after we got there, I'm sitting on the porch steps with our dog who we took with us. He's having a bite to eat. And I look up and there is a hummingbird so close to my face, I could see its eyes, the color of its eyes. And I knew that, you know, hummingbirds are sometimes known as messengers between the living and the dead. And I felt very strongly that this was my sister kind of flitting around, sort of discovering what things were like in the afterlife. So I ran inside the house, told everybody who was there, her three sons, their wives, Neil, Rob, Megan, what had just happened with this hummingbird. And I realized that this hummingbird was really an archetype for my sister's life. And one of her boys is a tattoo artist, and so is his fiance. So we all immediately started getting hummingbird tattoos. I just got mine at Christmas. And so that was one of the synchronicities. But then there were all these astrological synchronicities that happened. On the night of her death, let me back up a little bit. In 2008, when Pluto entered Capricorn, I kept thinking, oh my God, what's going to happen when Pluto conjuncts my natal moon, which was 29 degrees, 56 seconds of Capricorn in my fourth house of home and family. And I was afraid that when Pluto hit it, either I would die or somebody I loved would die. Well, as it turned out, it was Mary who died. And the night of her death, the conjunction was exact. The day of her memorial service, it was also exact. And I realized for some years, my birth time had been in question because I was born in Venezuela where everything is mañana, mañana. So even my mother had said, we don't know if that 3 p.m. birth time is correct, but it is. And, you know, I found out through my sister dying. But anyway, my whole point with that is that When you go through some type of crisis, especially when it's the death of somebody you love, you know this. You know, synchronicities are comforting. They make you realize how we're all, how everything and everyone is connected.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. And, you know, and I realized Annie was coming back And that not only that, that she had intentionally created an avatar to signal her presence 9 months before she died. I mean, that was, you guys experienced Annie's return.
Yeah, we did.
Tell us about that, if you will.
So weird. I mean, remember, Rob, when, you know, I think I was on your website and I'd read that Anne had died, and I was writing you an email about how sorry I was to hear about this. And suddenly there's this huge explosion. I mean, big explosion in our family room. And Rob jumps to his feet. The dog jumps off the couch. We all get up to go out the family room to see what it was. I thought maybe the TV had blown. And actually, Rob and I both thought it sounded like
transformer blowing. Like electrical transformer right inside our house, which doesn't exist. It was very, very startling. And we never found anything. You know, there was nothing. It fallen, nothing fallen from the walls, or there was nothing broken. And it was just, and then we told Whitley about it.
Yeah, and I told her, I said, is Anne stirring up hell on the other side? And you said, you bet she is.
Right. She was, well, you know, Anne was, she, what she was doing mostly was talking to people. She would say, at a moment when I was particularly in anguish, someone would get a message in their ear from Anne, and it would be Anne's voice saying, call Whitley. And they would call me at just these moments. I have a feeling what happened in your guys' case is one of you or both of you got that message and didn't respond to it, and she got pissed off because, take it from her husband, she's had a temper. and exploded on you. Oh, my free dreamlanders, those of you who listened in the commercial side of it, I have to tell you goodbye. And this warm, wonderful show, we're having such a joy. And so familiar, I mean, not familiar, but so full of wisdom. Because, you know, Trish and Rob have, they've been around the block a few times in this world and have been interested in the unexplained for a long time. And that works in your favor. You become, there's something beautiful comes into your soul. And you can see that here today. Mind-blowing synchronicities. Get it. You can get it through the unknowncountry.com store, probably at your local bookstore. It's loads of fun, very wise, and very empowering.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.